Good morning, friends. Today, you know, like today is the 10th day of the session. Today we are going to see the same like a Python session. Like I have shared my screen now, and today's session would be day 10, and the session's name would be Python iterators and generators, exception handling, try exception final, file reading writing. This is the 10th day of the session. That is this part, that is Python iterators, generators, exception handling, try except final, file reading writing. This is the session which we are going to discuss today. Yesterday, you know, like we have seen user defined built-in lambda regression functions, all type of functions which is used in Python, we have discussed yesterday. Today, you know, like we'll be seeing file IO input outputs. No, we'll be seeing today. Tomorrow we'll be going with classes. Our initial plan was like first 3 days would be statistics. In artificial intelligence session, first 3 days would be statistics. Day 4 to day 14 would be complete Python. After that, from day 14, like from day 415 to day 29 would be machine learning, and from day 30, that is, we would be starting a deep learning. Day 30 to day 40, it would be deep learning. 41, 42 would be natural language processing. 43 to 50 would be reinforcement learning. So this is our plan of our complete AI package. It would be like a 50 days free session, and absolutely it will be completely free session of what we are going to see today, or what we are going to see in all these 50 days. It starts from statistics, and it goes with Python. And after that, we'll go with machine learning. After that, it will go with deep learning. And there will be two natural language processing part, and there would be reinforcement learning part, which is going to happen in our series. So like you know, like if we open like you can visit our website, right? And you can take our phone numbers 9789888424. You can also WhatsApp as well. So if you go to our home page, you know, like you can find about us. So you can see here the about us part, like you can see that in our website. So if you want to know about us, no, you can just read about us part. And if you go to our YouTube channel, bigdatahandson.com. Please always subscribe to our channel. I'll know like a few of your friends know, or like they want to know these concepts. They just on an intermediate thing, no, they just read those one session, and they ask lots of doubts about that one session. We are not sticking with one session, and we take series of sessions. So if you are subscribing, it no. Like you can be able to see like whatever sessions we take, no, you can able to watch it out. Also, your doubts will be clear from there. So please try to subscribe our channel, no, before seeing you. That is, when you see your videos, you please subscribe to our channel. And until yesterday, all the sessions is been loaded. For past 2-3 days, no, I was out of station, and so like we are not able to load the sessions in YouTube. So until yesterday, you know, part 9, and see, like you can just check out like AI, part 9 of that 50-day series. So part 9 is completely loaded. You can see here we have mentioned as part 9. like part 9 is loaded, and so until part 9 is everything is being loaded, you can see AI part 5, part 8, part 7, part 6, part 4, 3, 2, 1, everything is being loaded in the 50 days English series of Artificial Intelligence. So now we shall continue our session now. So let me put down to Irfan now. Irfan, now we can continue the session. Thank you.
Thank you. So we'll continue today. So today we'll discuss about iterators and generators. Before that, we'll see variable scopes. Okay. So the first we'll see variable scope, and then we'll continue with iterators and generators. So variable scope is important when the variable needs to be accessed. Okay, where the variable or when a variable can accessible. Okay, variable scope controls that. Variable scopes are four types. That is, one is built-in scope, and another one is global, and then enclosed. Enclosed and local variable. So these four are the variable scopes: built-in scope, global scope, enclosed scope, and then local scope. Okay, so these four ways we can access a variable. Okay, and we can change the access also. Okay, so let me for example, let me demonstrate you. For example, sample function here, and in this function I having n equal to 10. Okay, now I'm going to print the value. Print n. Okay, now of course it will print the value if I call this function. Okay, so let's run this program. So it is printing the value 10, right? So now if I try to print the n value after the function calling, it is accessible or not? No, it's not accessible because name n is not defined. It's giving me name error because this n is a local variable. So remember that. So a variable inside a function, that will be a local variable. The local variable can't access in the global scope. Okay. So now this is a global scope. Actually, I'm accessing the n variable in the local scope, it's not accessible. Okay, sorry, global scope is not accessible. Okay, so now this is a local variable. Let's say for example I'm having a equal to 10 and b equal to 20. Okay, now I'm having a function called add, which will add these two numbers, a plus b. Is it accessible? Is the global variable, okay, now outside a function, okay, a variable outside a function, that is a global variable, global scope. Okay, now a variable inside a function, that is local variable, outside a function, that is global variable. Okay, so now what I'm doing, I'm having two global variables, and inside the function I'm trying to access the two variables, A and B. Okay. Sorry. Now it is allowed to access the global variable inside a local scope. Okay, it is allowed to access the global variable, but the permission is you can only access the variables, you can't change the values. For example, I'm trying to add a plus equal to 1. Okay, I'm just trying to update the a global variable. Okay, so now it will give me error because you don't have permission to change the value. You have permission to access the value, but you don't have permission to update or change the value. Okay, let's say I want to change the value a, but how can I do that? Okay, if you do like a equal to 1, if you do a equal to 1, it will create a new variable on local scope, not it will access the global scope, it will access only the local scope. Okay, so now it is giving me 21. Why? Is because a is becoming 1, but the global variable will not change. If I print global variable a after this, you will see the same 10. Okay, now it is creating a local variable a equal to 1, but it's not changing the value a, the global variable. To change the value of a global variable inside a local scope, you have a keyword called global. Okay, to change the permission, okay, to change the permission, we have a keyword called global. Okay, inside the function you can give the global keyword, and then you need to specify the variable a. Okay, now the global variable have the permission to change or access. Okay, we have all the permissions now. If I now I'm updating the global variable a plus equal to 1, then it will become 11. Okay, let's see what happens. So now I'm having the permission to change. Now the a is becoming 11 because in the local scope I'm updating the a variable using the global keyword. I'm changing the permissions of the global variable, and then we can update the global variable. Okay, so this is what about the global variable. Now let's see the enclosed variable. Okay, enclosed scope. So to explain the enclosed scope, we need another concept, that is function inside a function. So a loop inside a loop, it's possible. If class inside a if class is possible, then why can't a function? So function inside a function, it is possible. Okay, for example, I'm having a function called outer. It's an outer function. Okay, now inside that we have another function called inner. Okay, it is possible, right? Now in the outer function, I'm having a variable called c equal to 45, let's say. Okay, now inside the inner function, I'm having d equal to 30. Okay, now I'm going to print the sum of these two values, c plus d. Oh, okay, to call this inner function, you need to call this function in the outer function. Okay, in the outer function you need to call the inner function, and this outer function will be called outside, outside of the function outer. Okay, now let's run this. So it is giving me 75. Okay, the 45 plus 30 is 75, so we can access that. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm trying to change the c value. You're thinking C is a local variable, but that's not the case. Actually, C is a enclosed variable. So, okay, C is a enclosed variable. Enclosed scope only available when you have like a function inside a function. Okay, in that case only the enclosed scope is available. Okay, so we're having a enclosed variable called c equal to 45. We have the permission to access the value, but we don't have the permission to change the value. Okay, let's see what happens. So it is giving me error, unbound local error, local variable C reference before assignment. Okay, now to change the permission for the enclosed variable, we have a keyword called non-local. Non-local C, okay, understand? Non-local C will change the permissions. Now I have the permission to change the enclosed variable. Let's see. So now the 45 becomes 46, right? So the order comes here. This is a local variable, okay? This is a D is a local variable. C is an enclosed variable. A and B is the global variable. Understand? Now we have seen these three scopes. These two are global, A and B, and C is the enclosed variable. D is the local variable. Okay. So let's see built-in variables. So built-in scope is inside the interpreter, it will be understandable. So only, for example, we have a variable called underscore underscore name. So underscore underscore name every time contains a value called underscore underscore main, referring this is a main file. Okay, it says this sample.ten is the main file. Okay, if you are using the sample.ten inside the another file, then the name will be changed. Okay, will be name will be different value. That's what the use of the name variable here. So it's containing main, right? So it's the main file running the program. If you run this program inside another program, the name will be changed. Okay, for example, I'm trying to import the sample 10. Just for example, I'm saying, okay, don't worry about that. So the name will be changed, right? Sample 10. It's the name contains the name of the file, sample 10, right? This is the use of the name variable here. It is a built-in variable, okay? It's not stopping. Okay. So now we have seen the variable scope, the types of variable scopes. Okay, so now we'll continue with the iterators and generators. Okay, so what is iterators? Iterators are nothing but traversing a container. Okay, traversing a container means, for example, if you have a list called 1 2 3 4 5, it contains these five values. So traversing means first you will access 1 and then 2 and then 3 and then 4 and then 5. So we are traversing the list one by one, the values we are accessing one by one. So that's the iterators. Okay, that's called iterators. So actually we can also create an iterators when the class and objects oops concept will come. We'll see that creating an iterator. Okay, our customized iterators. Okay, so for creating an iterators in the class, you will have a function, the two functions next and iter. Okay, these two functions, we'll see that in our oops concept. Okay, so just for explaining, I'm just telling these two functions. Okay, so let's say, for example, I'm having a function called li 1 2 3 4 5, right? Okay, to create an iterator, okay, to for the iteration means traversing the container. Usually we use what we use for loop, right? For I in li print i. Can anyone imagine that how the for loop is working on the sequence data type only, how it is the for loop is working. Anyone have the idea about the performance of the, well, not performance, what to say, how the for loop is working on the sequence data types? So it is working only on sequence data type. Why it is? Because these data types are iterators. Okay, these data types are iterators. So the for loop works for the iterators only. So just I will demonstrate you this. Like, we know that the result will be like, first it will access 1, 2, then 3, 4, 5, like that, right? So we can also create an iterator. So it's just very simple. For example, I'm having a variable called it, okay? Now this will be my iterator. So it equal to, I'm going to call a function called iter. This function will help you to create the iterator for this iterable. Okay, iterable means it can iterate, you can iterate through this container. So that's the iterable type of data. So to access the variables, the value using the iterator, I'm not going to access the values through the variable li. I'm going to access through the iterator. Okay, so iterator will knows like first value it will give you, and then the next, and then the like one by one it will, the value will give you. Okay, to access the value we have a function called next. Okay, next will pick the next value from the iterator. Okay, if I run this program, it will give me 1. So it is access, it is just picking the first value. If I say another time, if I say print next of it, then it will give me the next value, 2, right? It is giving me 1 and 2, like the same way I'm doing for 5 times. Okay, right, 5 times I'm doing. Now it will give me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I think now you got the idea how the for loop is working, right? Anyone has the idea? Okay, let me tell you. So another thing is, if I call after the 5th time, if I call another time, the next, it will give me error. So I'm calling the 5 times the iterators, it is giving me 5 values. After that, no values there. So it is giving me stop iteration. Okay, so let's combine all these things. Let's create a for loop. Okay, our for loop, we are creating a customized. Okay, okay, to do that, so we have a variable called the list we have. So I will just remove all this. Okay, so now I need to iterate through the list. Okay, now I'm doing while. Okay, while true I'm doing. So it is an infinite loop. Okay, it's an infinite loop. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to create an iterator for the list. Iter of list. Okay, and then I'm going to print the next value of the iterator. Okay, that's it. Of course it will give me error, because when you are trying to access the next value, sorry, I think we need to create an iterator before the loop. So if you put inside the loop, every time it will create a new iterator, right? That's what, put the iterator in the before the loop. So of course it will give me error, stop iteration, because the for loop knows how to handle the error. Okay, it will not throw the error. If the it sees it's throwing the error, it will stop the loop. Okay, that's what the for loop will do. Okay, we can also do that. We'll see that on exception handling. Okay, the next topic we'll see now. So this is how the for loop is working with the try exceptional case, because it's accepting the exception, that is stop iteration. After the stop iteration, we can break the loop, break the infinite loop. Okay, this is how the for loop is working, remember. Okay, now we'll see the next one, generators. Generators also help to create the iterators only. Okay, but in a different way. I will tell you what it is. Generators are usually defined in a function. Okay, for example, I'm having a gen function. Okay, I'm going to create a generator. Okay, to create a generator, it's very simple. For example, I'm having a variable called I equal to 10. Okay, I equal 10. Now, to create a generator, we need to use a special keyword called yield. Okay, yield the a value, yield a value. Okay, now it's similar to return, but it's different. Actually, the yield will not break the loop. Okay, you can just simply stop the execution of the function. Okay, first call, it will run this yield until the first yield. Okay, and then if you are calling the next time the gen function you are calling, then it will run until the next yield statement where it is. Okay, yield I, let's say. In between what it what the statement it has, it will execute. For example, I'm having a statement first call. And in between them, second call. Okay. In second call, I'm going to change the value actually to see the changes. Okay. Now let's create the iterator for the generator. Okay. It's very simple. You need to create a variable. For example, x equal to, I'm calling the gen function. This is the first call. I'm calling the gen function. Okay. And I'm going to print the next value, means I'm calling the, sorry, we need to create an iterator first. Iterator for the x. Okay, the function for the generator, we can say. And then I'm calling the next of iterator. Then it will give me, and then it will run the execute the program until the first yield statement. Okay, and then I'm calling, if I'm calling the next time, okay, I'm calling the next time, then it will execute until the next yield statement. Okay, this is how the generator works actually. Okay, let's run this program. So you can see on the first call, next of IT, it's just running the execute to the this lines code, this sense of code. Okay, I equal 10, it is assigning, and then it is printing the first class actually, first call, and then it is yielding the I. It is the similar to returning the I value. Okay, so it is returning the I 10, and then we are printing the 10 value here using the print function. And then I'm calling another time the next, so it will execute until the next yield statement. Okay, now it is printing the second call, and then it is incrementing the value I with one value, and then it is yielding the I value. Now the I value it is printing using the print function. Okay, 11. This is how the generator works. Okay, you can create an infinite generator actually. Infinite generator means, let me create, for example, natural numbers. Okay, natural numbers. Here I'm having n equal to 0, let's say, and then I'm having a loop while true. Okay, this is an infinite loop. Now I'm going to yield the n value. Okay. Now, whenever I'm calling the natural function, it will give me one value, one natural number. Okay, sorry. I think we need to increment the value actually. N plus equal to 1. Okay. Every time it will increment the value. Now we'll create a iterator for that. It equal to iter through the generator, that is natural function, and then we are going to call the function with the next statement, next of it. Okay, let's see. Now it will give me 1, and then if I'm calling next time, it will give me 2. Like that, infinitely it will do. 1, 2. If I do for for loop na, if I do using the for loop for I in natural, because this function, the for loop also, inside the for loop, it is creating an iterable object, and then it is doing the next statement. That's why the for loop also the same what we did before this one. Okay. Now I am printing the I value. So it will run infinitely. These two lines will run infinitely. Let's see. Okay. You can see here it is running infinitely. Right? So you can stop this execution. Oh, it's not stopping. Yeah. Okay. Now it stopped. Okay. So this is how the infinitely you can create a loop. Or you can create a iterator using the generator. Okay, now in the same concept, we'll create a generator for Fibonacci series infinitely. Okay, if I call the Fibonacci the function, it needs to create the next element. Like that, infinitely we need to create. How can you do that? Anyone using this infinite concept? Okay. Infinitely, we need to create the Fibonacci series. Anyone has the idea? Okay, let me create. I'm going to create a function, Fibonacci, and then inside the function. So we have already done the Fibonacci series using a for loop. So what we did, we created two initial variables by assigning 0 and 1, these two values. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to yield these two values first. Yield the fib 0 and yield the, because these two are the first values, actually initial values. And then it will yield the fib 1. Sorry. So now our infinite loop will start here, from here. While true. So we are going to calculate the fib equal to fib 0 plus fib 1, right? And then we will yield the result fib. Okay, and then we'll swap the variable, like fib 0 will become fib 1 and fib 1 will become fib. Okay, now let's create the iterator it for the Fibonacci iter function, and then give the function Fibonacci. So let's call the next value, print next of, I'm just copy and paste in few times. Okay, 5 times I'm giving. Now let's see, it's working or not. Okay, actually it is working, right? 0 first value, then 1, and then adding these two values, 2 and like 3, like that it will go. Okay, if I do with the for loop, then it will work for infinitely, for I in Fibonacci print I. Okay, now it will give me infinitely. Okay, infinitely it goes on. Let's start stop the execution. Okay, so now we have the clear understanding of iterators and generators. Okay, let's move on to the next concept, exception handling. Okay, exception handling used to not to happen or handle the exception, because if you see an exception comes now, then it will stop the execution. It will ignore the statements after the line where the error is came. Okay, that's why we need to handle the error. Okay, not to stop the execution. Okay, it is stopping the execution by the error, because of the error. Okay, so if we stopped the if we handle the error, then we can stop by stopping the execution. Okay, so for example, let's say I'm having a number n equal to 45, I'm then divided by 0. What it will happen? Anyone? I'm having the number 45. Now I'm dividing it with 0. It will throw me an error. Now the error is zero division error. So just note the names, all the names. Okay, let's say for example I'm having a list 1 2 3 4 5. Okay, so I'm printing li of 10. What it will give me? So it is giving me index error. Okay, because the 10th index is not available in the list, that's why. Okay, you can see now if the error is coming here, then it stopped the execution the other lines. Okay, so we saw these two errors, index error and what, zero division error. Now I'm just putting a space before the li. What will happen? Now it is giving me an error, unexpected indent. Okay, now let's say for example I'm having a tuple. TUP tuple 10, 20, 30. Now top of 2 equal to 10. So what will give me? The result will be an error. What the error is? Type error. Okay. Now we have seen the type error. Now let's see, for example, I'm having a dictionary. Stop the execution. I'm having the dictionary 101 colon any values, like for example like this, and then 102 something here. Okay, now print D of 103. Is 103 keys available in the dictionary? No, then it will give me a error. The error is key error. Okay, just I'm just telling these all things to note the what the names of the errors, key error, index error, type error, zero division error, like indentation error. Okay, for example, let's print int. I'm just converting the string to integer, right? I'm having the integer at the same time I'm having a character here, g. What will happen? So the error is what? Value error. Okay, so now we have seen some couple of errors here. Okay, so now let's try to handle the error. Okay, try to handle the error. You just comment all these lines or just okay. Okay, so to handle the error, we have a special block called try except block. So try, in begin with the try keyword, and inside the try you need to give the statements. Okay, statements of lines, these lines you need to give where the error will come. You are expecting maybe this line can get this error, so just put the line inside the try block. Okay, for example, the n divided by 0. Okay, so this will give me, of course it will give me error, n divided by 0. Now we have another block called except. This block accepts the exception. Okay, now what the error will come here? Okay, n divided by 0 means it will come zero division error. So after the except, after the space, you need to give the name of the error, zero division error. Okay, and then put colon, and inside the inside the block, what you need to do is you can give some messages. Okay, you can do whatever you want inside the block. So the use of the try except block is it will not stop the execution. Okay, execution of the file. Okay, it will just jump to the where the except block is. If the error is coming here, then jump to the exception block. Okay, now it will give me some messages. For example, can't divide by 0. Okay, now if I'm having a statements after the try except block, it will execute. Okay, it will not stop the execution. That's why we have the exception handling. Okay, now it is giving me can't divide by 0. Okay, and then it is giving me hi. That's how you can accept the exception. So it is possible you to have multiple except blocks. Multiple except blocks means we can have multiple errors, no, like this one, for example. I'm copying these things. Okay, so the next error will be, for example, value error. Value error where will come? In this step, right? Trying to convert a character into the integer, right? The message will be, for example, can't convert char to int. Okay, so this is the value error. See, can't divide by 0. Actually, that is a problem in the try exception block. That is, if you saw this error, print n divided by 0, it just jumped to the exception block, but it is not executing all these codes. Okay, this is the problem here. Okay, if you want to run, okay, so we'll see that later. Let's comment this line. Run. So it is ignoring the other lines actually. Okay, if the error is come in this line, then it will ignore these two lines and jump into the exception where the except block is. Okay, the corresponding except block. That means I'm accepting the value error in this block, then it will come in this block only. Okay, we have another block, except exception. Exception means it knows everything. For example, you know, you don't know what error will come here. Okay, in this line, for example, what error will come, you don't know. Then you can use the exception. So this exception will knows everything. I'm just putting alias E. Now I'm printing a E because this exception class knows all the errors and it gives a message to the error. Okay. Now let's comment this line. Now this line will be key error, but we don't have the block for key error, so it will go to the exception block, and this exception block will give you a message. Wait, what is doing? D of 103. Okay, it is giving me the key, no problem. We'll see for value, sorry, type error. If you accept the type error, then it is giving me a message: tuple object does not support item assignment. Because we don't have any block for type error, it goes to the exception block and then it is printing a message. Okay, so one more thing, always put the exception block in the last one, because if you put in the first one, so what it will do, it will ignore these two blocks. For example, if you have a zero division error in the first, then it will go for the exception only, not our zero division error block. Okay, that's why you always need to put the exception block in the last one. Division by zero is not the message what we are given here, because it is going to the exception block. Okay, always give the exception block in the last one. Okay, so now we know that after getting the in this line we are getting the error, then it is jumped to the exception block and not executing these lines. So let's say, for example, you are opening a file but you are not closing the file, just jumping to the exception statement and then exiting from the try except blocks, then what will happen, the file will be locked. Okay, so we don't have to do that. Actually, there is a block called final. So finally block will help you to execute the command which are very important. Okay, so it must needs to be executed, very much important. So what error will come, what will happen, but finally definitely will execute. Okay, always the finally block will execute. And one more thing, the finally block needs to be in the last one. Okay, this is the rules. Finally block needs to be in the last one. You can have multiple except blocks, but only one finally block. So to have the except block, you need to have try block in the first. Okay, this is how the try except block, so you can handle the exceptions. Okay, now we'll move on to the next one, file reading writing. Okay, now let's see file reading. For example, we having the sample 10 file, okay? I want to read this file, okay? So to do that, in Python, to read a file, first we need to open the file, okay? To open the file, we have a function called open. It's the built-in function which will open the file, okay? So after opening the file, it will return the file object. You can store it in a variable, for example, f equal to open, okay? Inside this open, you need to give some parameters, that is file name, what file name or path, okay? If the file is something somewhere else, then you need to give the full path, okay? Full path means the location you need to give, okay? Otherwise, if you have the file where the sample 13 is executing, then you can just give the file name itself, sample10.py, okay? Now I'm going to give the mode, okay? Mode is what purpose you are going to use this file. You're going to create the file, or you're going to write or read, or you're going to append. There is various modes are there. I'll just show you this. So these are the modes. Mode R means opens a file for reading, okay? To read the file. W is to for writing, opens a file for writing, okay? X opens a file for execution. If the file already exists, the operation will fail. And in the write operation also we have a problem. Creates a new file if it does not exist, and it truncates the file if it exists, okay? If in the file having some contents, then it will remove the contents, okay? It will create a new file only. And append opens a file for appending at the end of the file without truncating it, actually without return clearing the content. It will append the lines in the last line, okay? Creates a new file if it does not exist, okay? And then T opens in text mode. We have two modes, text mode and binary mode. So defaultly that is text mode, okay? You can open the file for binary operations also. For example, if you want to read MP4 file, for example, some audio file, video file, so that will be a binary format, right? So you need to read as a binary. And then we have plus, opens a file for updating, reading and writing both, okay? Now let's see. Now I'm going to read the file, right? I'm going to read the file. So defaultly that is read the file. So I'm just giving R here. R means read the file. Okay, now the object is created. So to read the content of the file, it's very simple. Just put F dot read. Okay, inside we have a read function. Okay, you can give the size or else defaultly it will read all the contents. So inside the sample 10 we have this content, right? So this is how you can read the file. Okay, now let's create a new file. Okay, I'm creating a text file, txt, okay, text file. I'm creating the file for writing, okay? For writing, we can create just W, okay? W for a writing. I'm not going to read now. I'm going to write a line on the file, okay? To write, we have a function called write, okay? Write just a single line, it will write, okay? For example, good morning, okay? After writing the file, it is very very important you to close the file, okay? This is an operation. First you need to open and do some read and write operations, and then close the file. Okay, now if I run this file, it will create a new file in this directory, you can see. So now it is created a file, sample.txt. inside the file you can see good morning here, right? If I run this one more time and with another line, so if we run this program, then what it will do, it will clear the content of the file and then it is writing the new lines. It is good morning and then how are you. Okay, so it is not coming on the new line because you need to provide a character, that is escape character slash n. So now you can see it is on the new line. Okay, so the write operation will remove, will truncate all the content in the sample.txt file and then write again. Okay, if you want to append it, you need to open the file as an append mode. Okay, A. If you're using append mode, then it will not remove the contents from the file, it will just write on the last line. Okay, this is how it is. Okay, so we have seen the write, read and append. Okay, now we'll see. Okay, before that, this format is not efficient actually. Open a file and read write operation and then close a file. Actually, in this type of method, if we have an error in the reading writing operation, then it will exit the execution without closing the file, so it will be very dangerous. So we have another method to read a file by using a block called with block. You can use with and then open the file open the file and the file is sample.txt. okay, as you need to give a file name, let's say file here. Okay, now we can read the content. Okay, I'm going to change the mode as read and then we are going to read from the file dot read the content, right? Okay, so this method will help you if you do not have the line file dot close. The with statement, inside that itself, it will close the file. Okay, if in the with block, if the line is executed and then it is it is exiting the block without closing the file, then the with statement will close the file automatically. Okay, so we have written the lines and then this with the block, it is reading the file. Okay, that's how you can read a file, read or write. Okay, any doubts? Now from this we can end the session. Any doubts you have, you can ask now. Maybe this one actually, wait, on the for loop creation, let's complete it by using a try except block. So we are going to try and then print the next. We will exit the loop when we saw the stop iteration error. Okay, if it throws the stop iteration, you need to break the loop. Okay, that's how we completed the for loop. Okay, this is how the for loop works. So any doubts? We'll end up this session. Any doubts?
Actually, can you explain that yield variable?
What variable?
What is the purpose of the yield? Yield.
By yield name. Statement.
Yes.
Yield. Okay. So it is the keyword to create the generator actually. What it will do, it is same as the return, but it is different actually, because it is returning the value I, and at the same time it's the generator, it is creating a generator. That means it will execute the function until the first yield statement. Okay, after that it will stop the execution, and then if you are calling the next time, then it will run execute the lines until the next yield statement. This is how the yield works actually. Okay, it's help you to create the generator. Okay, now it will stop the execution, and then it will run the execution after the yield statement, and then until the next yield statement. Okay. Got it?
Okay. Yeah, thanks.
Hi. Hi, Irfan.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. Yeah.
Please explain the iteration and the generator module.
No, I'm not getting it.
Can you please explain the iterator and the generator?
Iterators. So iterators are nothing but traversing a containers. Okay, so if you have a list, you can traverse the values and one by one, so one and then two and then three, like that. So to traverse the list, you need to create an iterator. Okay, to create an iterator, you can use the function called iter. Okay, you can provide the iterable object, and then it will create the iterator. So to access the value from the iterator, you need to call the next function. Okay, the next function will give you the next value of the iterator. Okay, this is how the iteration process will work. Got it?
So iterator is an incrementer. I mean, like
yeah, actually a list is a class, right? Inside the class they will have these two methods, next and iter. So this iter function will remember that. Okay, will remember I have already returned this value. Now I need to return the next value, 2, that is 2, and then I need to return the next value, 3. Okay, it will remember, the object will remember. Okay, any other doubts? Any other notes? Last call. We'll wind up the session from this.
So how we know how many exceptions are there? If we don't know the exception, what exception it will raise, we can use exception, right?
You can search it in Google actually. There's a bunch of exception actually. Some few exception I have shown you. The value error, type error, key error, index error, like that. Usually these are the common errors will come actually. Okay, any other doubts? Okay, let's end this session. So we are bigdatahandson.com. Our website bigdatahandson.com. You can visit our website. So this is a part 9 video. This video will be uploaded as soon as possible in our YouTube channel. Okay. our YouTube channel bigdataandsome.com. If you subscribe to our channel, you will get all the notifications. It is taking longer. Okay, our website bigdataandsome.com. And you can see our videos here as well by clicking the video icon. And the videos you can see in the upload meetup videos tab. Okay. Our YouTube channel is bigdataandsome.com. This is our YouTube channel. All the videos have been uploaded. We'll upload this video as well as soon as possible. Okay. And then let's see tomorrow. From tomorrow, we'll see the OOPS concept, object-oriented programming in Python. Okay. Let's see tomorrow. Bye.
Okay.